Good day, children. So we move on to part 3 of the lesson. So in the first two parts, we saw how Bholi, the simpleton, was, she was basically neglected by her family because of her appearance, and also the child could not speak without stammering. So she was not considered important in her family, and because school, primary school for girls was opened in their village, and her father happened to be a representative of the government. Her father puts her into the school, and she goes to school, and there she is initially scared on seeing a lot of children, and she was also hopeful that one of them would become her friend. And when the teacher approaches her, she feels shy and she does not speak, but the teacher encourages her to speak, and she finally manages to speak a word or two, and she feels confident enough to speak forward in life because of the encouragement she received from her teacher. Now moving on. Thus the years passed. The village became a small town. The little primary school became a high school. There were now a cinema under a tin shed and a cotton ginning mill. The mail train began to stop at the railway station. So years had passed and the village grew into a small town. And Bholi's primary school was now a high school. There was a cinema which was under a tin shed, and there was a cotton ginning mill. Ginning means is the process of treating cotton. Okay, and even the mail train started to stop at the village railway station. One night after dinner, Ramlal said to his wife, "Then shall I accept Bishambar's proposal?" "Yes, certainly," his wife said. "Bholi will be lucky to get such a well-to-do bridegroom, a big shop, a house of his own, and I hear several thousand in the bank. Moreover, he is not asking for any dowry." "That's right, but he is not so young, almost the same age as I am. And he also limps. Moreover, the children from his first wife are quite grown up." So, one night Ramlal was discussing with his wife that he had got a marriage proposal or offer for Bholi, and he asked his wife whether to accept Bishambar's proposal or not. So his wife replies that they should definitely accept the proposal because it was suitable for Bholi. Now she supported her view by saying that Bishambar had a big shop, he owned a house, and he had cash deposit in the bank. Also, he was not asking for any dowry. Ramlal was a bit unsure because Bishambar was, Ramlal's age and was handicapped also because he had a limp. So, Bishambar also had grown-up children from his first marriage. "So, what does it matter?" his wife replied. 45 or 50? It is no great age for a man. We are lucky that he is from another village and does not know about her pockmarks and her lack of sense. If we don't accept this proposal, she may remain unmarried all her life." "Yes, but I wonder what Bholi will say." "What will that witless one say? She is like a dumb cow." "Maybe you're right," muttered Ramlal. In the other corner of the courtyard, Bholi lay awake on her cot, listening to her parents' whispered conversation. So, Ramlal's wife said that there was no harm in it if there was a big age gap between Bholi and the groom. She said that they could not find any other match for Bholi, and she also says that it was this man was from another village, and therefore he does not know about Bholi's mental condition and her ugly face. And Ramlal said that he was worried about how Bholi would react to it, but her mother replies that Bholi was like a dumb cow, and she wouldn't say anything. Bholi was listening to all this, lying in her bed nearby, and she was listening to all this conversation. Bishambar Nath was a well-to-do grocer. He came with a big party of friends and relations with him for the wedding. A brass band playing a popular tune from an Indian film headed the procession, with the bridegroom riding a decorated horse. Ramlal was overjoyed to see such pomp and splendor. He had never dreamt that his fourth daughter would have such a grand wedding. Bholi's elder sisters who had come for this occasion were envious of her luck. When the auspicious moment came, the priest said, "Bring the bride." Bholi clad in a red silken bridal dress, was led to the bride's place near the sacred fire. So, the bridegroom Vishwambarnath was a rich man. He had a grocery shop. Grocery, a shop where you sell a lot of goods and food items, okay? So, he was a grocer and he used to sell food items and household goods. He had a good business. And on the wedding day, he came with his friends and family, and they were accompanied by a brass band which was playing a popular tune from Hindi movies. And the bridegroom was riding a decorated horse, and Ramlal was very happy to see all this. You know, splendor means lavishness. Okay, he had never dreamt of such a grand wedding for his fourth daughter. And Bholi's elder sisters, who had come for this occasion, they were envious of her or jealous of Bholi's good luck. And when the good time, auspicious means good time. So on the wedding day, Bholi was brought for the wedding rituals, and she was dressed in a red silk sari. Okay, garland the bride, one of his friends prompted Vishwambarnath. The bridegroom lifted the garland of yellow marigolds. A woman slipped back the silken veil from the bride's face. Vishwambar took a quick glance. The garland remained poised in his hands. The bride slowly pulled down the veil over her face. "Have you seen her?" said Vishwambar to the friend next to him. "She has pockmarks on her face." "So what? You're not young either." "Maybe, but if I am to marry her, her father must give me 5,000 rupees. Ramlal went and placed his turban, his honour, at Bishambar's feet. "Do not humiliate me so. Take 2,000 rupees. "No, 5,000 or we go back. Keep your daughter." "Be a little considerate, please. If you go back, I can never show my face in the village." "Then out with 5,000. Tears streaming down his face, Ramlal went in, opened the safe and counted out the notes. He placed the bundle at the bridegroom's feet. So when Bholi reached the venue, one of Bishamba's friends asked him to garland the bride. And as he was about to put the garland around her neck, a woman removed the veil that covered Bholi's face. And he saw the blemishes on her face and at once objected to the marks on the bride's face. So his friend answered that, you know, he should ignore this as he himself was not young to marry a young girl like her. Vishwambar told Ramlal that he wanted 5,000 rupees in return for marrying an ugly woman like Bholi. And on hearing the bridegroom's demand, Ramlal got so upset that he went to him and kept his turban at his feet. Now, turban is a representation of a man's honor. So it was basically Ramlal was keeping his honor at the bridegroom's feet. And he requested him to be considerate and requested him to accept 2,000 rupees instead of 5,000 as dowry. Now, Vishwambar was firm and said that he could keep his daughter at home for 2,000 rupees. So then Ramlal requested him not to do all this as it would ruin his pride in front of the whole village. But Vishwambar was adamant on his demand of 5,000 rupees. And Ramlal went inside and brought 5,000 rupees from the safe, counted the money and handed it over to Vishwambar. Okay, humiliate means insult. Okay, streaming, flowing. Okay, on Bishamba's greedy face appeared a triumphant smile. He had gambled and won. "Give me the garland," he announced. So, triumphant means winning and gambled means a bet. So, now the bridegroom was very happy because he had won the bet and he asked for the garland, which shows that he was ready for the marriage. Once again, the veil was slipped back from the bride's face, but this time her eyes were not downcast. She was looking up, looking straight at her prospective husband, and in her eyes there was neither anger nor hate, only cold contempt. Vishwambar raised the garland to place it around the bride's neck, but before he could do so, Bholi's hand struck out like a streak of lightning and the garland was flung into the fire. She got up and threw away the veil. So Bholi removed the cover of her face and stared at Vishwambar. Okay, her eyes were full of disrespect for him. There was no anger or hatred in her eyes. As Vishwambar was about to garland her, she just struck her hand at the garland as quick as a streak of lightning. Okay, and the garland flew and fell into the sacred fire, and she threw away her veil too. Flung means aim or launch. Pitaji, said Bholi in a clear loud voice, and her father, mother, sisters, brothers, relations and neighbors were startled to hear her speak without even slightest stammer. Pitaji, take back your money. I'm not going to marry this man. Ramlal was thunderstruck. The guests began to whisper, so shameless, so ugly and so shameless. So Bholi addressed her father by saying Pitaji, and her voice was clear and she spoke without stammering. And her family was shocked to see this. And she continued and said that her father should take back his money as she would not marry this man. Ramlal was shocked to hear all that, and even the relatives started whispering that the girl was shameless as she was refusing to the marriage. Bholi, are you crazy? Shouted Ramlal. You want to disgrace your family? Have some regard for our Izzat. For the sake of your Izzat, said Bholi, I was willing to marry this lame old man, but I will not have such a mean, greedy and contemptible coward as my husband. I won't. What a shameless girl. We all thought she was a harmless, dumb cow. So Ramlal grew angry and he shouted at Bholi that, you know, she had gone mad because such an act of her could bring disgrace to their family. Now Bholi replied that it was for the sake of her family's honor that she had consented to marry the lame old man, but she was not ready to marry a greedy coward like him. Contemptible means offensive. And thunderstruck, shocked. Okay. What a shameless girl. We all thought she was a harmless dumb cow. Bholi turned violently on the old woman. Yes, auntie, you are right. You all thought I was a dumb driven cow. That's why you wanted to hand me over to this heartless creature. But now the dumb cow, the stammering fool, is speaking. Do you want to hear more? So an old woman commented that Bholi was a shameless girl, though they all thought that she was a dull and innocent girl. Dumb means dull here. Okay. And Bholi looked at her with extreme anger and said that everyone thought that she was a fool. And that is why they wanted to marry her off to an unkind man. They called her shameless because she could take a stand for herself. Bishambarnath, the grocer, started to go back with his party. The confused bandsmen thought this was the end of the ceremony and struck up a closing song. Ramlal stood rooted to the ground, his head bowed low with the weight of grief and shame. And Ramlal was in deep sorrow because he was feeling ashamed. Okay, the groom and the party left, and the confused bandsmen, they thought that the ceremony was over. So they played the closing song. They also followed the groom. The flames of the sacred fire slowly died down. Everyone was gone. Ramlal turned to Bholi and said, but what about you? No one will ever marry you now. What shall we do with you? Now Ramlal was in deep sorrow. He was feeling ashamed, and the flames of the sacred fire died after some time, and the guests too went away. He then asked Bholi that what would be her future now and who would marry her. Rooted means fixed. Grief, sorrow. Okay. And Sulekha said in a voice that was calm and steady, don't you worry, Pitaji. In your old age, I will serve you and mother, and I will teach in the same school where I learnt so much. Isn't that right, ma'am? The teacher had all along stood in a corner watching the drama. Yes, Bholi, of course, she replied, and in her smiling eyes was the light of a deep satisfaction that an artist feels when contemplating the completion of her masterpiece. So Bholi replied that, you know, she would take care of both her parents and would teach in the same school that had made her learn so much. She sought the approval from her teacher, who was quietly watching all this drama. She approved Bholi's statement, and she was deeply satisfied with Bholi's response to this whole situation. The satisfaction was similar to the way an artist feels when he sees his masterpiece once it is complete. Okay, so this was the lesson, Bholi. And look at the way, you know, towards the end. Initially, the lesson begins by addressing Bholi as Sulekha. But throughout the lesson, we only see the name Bholi, the simpleton, coming up, isn't it? We do not get to hear her name Sulekha referred anywhere in the middle of the story, or, you know, as the story progressed. But At the end, when Bholi speaks out, the narrator again addresses her as Sulekha. So which shows that she has established herself as Sulekha. She has created her own identity and she is no longer the simpleton, the Bholi that she was or that people thought who she was to be. She was no longer the simpleton, she was no longer the dumb cow that people thought her to be. She was an independent woman, she who had her own views, who had an independent stand, okay, and she had created her own identity against all the odds in the society. Okay, so I hope you understood this lesson. Thank you, children.